next matter to come before us this morning is State of Ohio, Mrs. Shannon Haywood. Both sides will have 15 minutes to present oral argument. The appellant may reserve up to 5 minutes for rebuttal. If you want me to keep track of the time, let me know you want to reserve rebuttal, and I'll let you know when you're reaching that rebuttal time. We have read the briefs, and we're ready to see when you are.
May it please the court, Peter Gallier for Deshaun Haywood, reserve 5 minutes. This presentation will focus on the double jeopardy issues presented in Assignments of Error 1 through 4, and if there's time, the Miranda issue presented in Assignment of Error 6. This record demonstrates two truths. First, the trial court was not biased. And second, the state fabricated judicial bias allegations to manipulate the system to get a new jury. That manipulation was the equivalent of goading a mistrial. Double jeopardy aims to prevent prosecutors from seeking a new trial to improve known or suspected weaknesses, and in equal measure protects a defendant's substantial valued right to a particular tribunal. There is no constitutional right to peremptory challenges. They are not indispensable to a fair trial. Accordingly, they cannot be elevated over a defendant's double jeopardy rights. But that is what happened here. Jeopardy attached in this case because, first, the jury was fully selected, qualified, and unbiased. And second, but for the state misconduct and the trial court allowance, the technical swearing in would have occurred. Because jeopardy attached, the state had to demonstrate manifest necessity. But manifest necessity could never be established here because there was no judicial bias. The totality of the voir dire and the trial court's response in the Supreme Court of Ohio demonstrates that what the state identified as bias was actually just the trial court exercising sound case, docket, party, and courtroom management. Nothing in this record establishes bias. Rather, the record demonstrates an even-handed approach. Other legal considerations and constitutional considerations support these conclusions. There is a presumption of regularity in proceedings below, and there is a presumption that judges are not biased. There is no right to seat a particular juror. There is also no right to remove a particular juror.
Counsel, I'm just thinking, I know the state's response to all this with the judges, well, that should have been, you know, that's regulated by the Ohio Supreme Court, okay? And you said, you know, that in this particular case, it's an exception because the court recused herself before an affidavit of prejudice was actually filed. Is that right?
That's an element of it. The other element is what should have happened here is the jury should have been impaneled. And that way, the merits of the state's allegations would determine whether its peremptory challenge could trump Mr. Haywood's double jeopardy rights.
Well, I guess getting back to my point is, I guess where I'm getting a little confused with, you know, whether it should have been something that we look at or whether the Supreme Court looks at, it seems to me like you're really asking us to evaluate it as the Supreme Court, because we have to evaluate just what you were saying. There's no evidence of bias here. There's no evidence that the judge should have recused herself, which were all things that the court should be doing, not us. That's how I'm concerned about it, at least. So how do you respond to that?
The response is the way everything happened here, The merits of bias have not been reached. If that can go unchecked, then the state, through misconduct, gets a free pass in this set of circumstances, pre-impaneling the jury, or in any biased situation where the state is seeking a new trial based upon a perceived weakness or a known weakness. When the trial court voluntarily gets out of the way and the merits can never be reached on the bias, there's no protection within the system other than, in this case, at this stage. The record, it would be different if there was any legitimacy to the claims within, supported within this record. That, admittedly, that would be a closer case. But there is no legitimacy to the claims from the state here. The trial court's response to the Supreme Court of Ohio, which is in this record as part of the August 5th, 2014 response to the state's request to quash the jury at Exhibit D, demonstrates that what the trial court was doing was managing the parties, managing the case, managing her docket, managing the people within her courtroom. That's all the trial court was doing. The state's...
If your argument is that the trial judge should not have been allowed to voluntarily recuse, which the subsequent judge didn't reach that issue, said that the subsequent judge said trial judge does not have authority, but we're going to get a new jury based on what happened. I'm not going to delve into whether or not what happened tainted the jury. Two questions. What would be the remedy you're seeking for that? And number, because we can't necessarily unring that bell at this point. And number two, is the relevance just about the last jury that was impaneled? Do you understand what I'm saying?
There shouldn't have been a second or a third trial.
And what's the remedy for that this court can give in terms of that?
The remedy would be vacate the convictions with prejudice. There should, because double jeopardy attached, there shouldn't have been a second and third trial. Legal and constitutional considerations support these conclusions. Again, the parties have a right to a fair trial, not perfect trial. The state sought a favorable trial, and that's buttressed by the state's conduct in the second trial, with the Brady violations, with the state then voluntarily agrees to a new trial, a third trial, and voluntarily removes itself from the prosecution. The Batson standard, by necessity, is highly deferential to trial courts. And even if the trial court was wrong in its legal conclusion, we don't concede that it was, but even if it was, that is not demonstrative of bias at all. And it had no impact on the fairness of the trial. Factual considerations also support these conclusions. There were multiple close calls in cause challenges that went in the state's favor and went against Mr. Haywood. Mr. Haywood's motion to suppress went against him. This record, objectively, demonstrates an even-handed approach by the court. The state conceded, and this is paramount, the state conceded that the Batson juror could not be removed for cause. If this were a cause situation, and the trial court got it wrong on cause, it'd be a different case, because that goes to whether or not this jury can provide a fair verdict. But that's not what was at issue here. It was solely a peremptory charge, or a challenge.
I have a question for you. You're asking this court to change the rule that the Supreme Court has stated and the state of Ohio has stated that the jeopardy attaches when the jury is impaneled and sworn. This jury, the first jury, was never sworn. So it was never came to the point where we've got a jury, we're ready to roll, tomorrow's the first day, we're done. It never got to that point the first time around. So how are we supposed to decide that that's wrong? Impaneling is enough. They don't have to be sworn, they just have to be impaneled.
That characterization is not accurate to precisely what happened here. The jury was within seconds of being sworn in, and the state interjected itself to prevent that from happening, and the trial court allowed that interjection. And it's those two in tandem that functions to wipe out and obliterate this technicality.
Okay, so hypothetically, then, if it's your contention that jury would have been fair and everything would have gone just fine, that jury should have stayed because it was a fair trial for Mr. Haywood.
Correct.
Are you saying that the second or the third jury wasn't fair?
Again, the second and third trials should not have happened.
But they did, and there were separate juries. Were those juries were they going to be unfair? Was there bias in those juries? I guess my question is, where's the harm to your client?
There is a valued constitutional right to have a case heard by a particular tribunal. That's the harm. Correct.
No offense, but you're still not answering her question. That may be the law, mm-hmm. you know, what you're saying, but her question is, okay, so what? So what? What does that matter? I mean, just in essence, that's what she's saying. Where is your prejudice?
The prejudice is that the way it transpired, the state's peremptory was elevated above this valued constitutional substantial right.
So you're saying structural error. It's just in the fact that that happened. That's the
correct. Just like any double jeopardy violation.
Okay. All right.
And you just now reached that 5 minutes. You may continue to reserve as you wish.
Because the state's allegations were meritless and a pure manipulation of the system to gain a more favorable jury, there never should have been a second and third trial. And we ask this court to vacate Mr. Haywood's convictions with prejudice.
Morning. May it please the court. My name is Anthony Miranda, Assistant Prosecuting Attorney for Cuyahoga County, Special Prosecutor in this case. I think questions hit on the essential point here that opposing counsel wants to focus on the first and second juries and not the third jury, which actually rendered the guilty verdicts before the court today. The law is clear, we say to this court's decision in Sutton, that jeopardy does not attach until the jury is impaneled and sworn. And technicalities matter in the law. It doesn't matter if we're seconds or minutes close to rendering a verdict. That doesn't mean we can say we have a verdict. A verdict is rendered when it's signed.
Well, if we take appellant's argument that the only reason why this happened before the jury was sworn is because the state took action with improper purpose, is the remedy that's right and it was double jeopardy, or is the remedy something else? In other words, what is the sanction on the state if in fact it took an improper purpose by doing what it did right before the jury was sworn? So double jeopardy did not attach under the law. You understand the question?
I think so. So to assume that bad purpose for purposes
assume.
Of Your Honor's question, then the only cases that appellant cites to are goading mistrials. And those talk about where, like, the prosecutor would do something inappropriate to get a witness to render something inadmissible. And that makes sense. Then you're making the defendant essentially go through a whole other trial. Jeopardy has attached. In this case, the prosecution took the step of preventing jeopardy from attaching, which I think means we don't even get to that analysis. The jury hasn't been sworn. Double jeopardy hasn't attached. And so there is no right to a particular jury.
Counsel, if I can stop you, but I think Judge Hensel is saying is, but the point is, is there a remedy for prosecutorial misconduct in preventing a jury from being impaneled? In other words, for whatever reason, the prosecutor feels, let's say, that this jury is not going to be fair to the state, and he doesn't want the jury impaneled. So let's say the state just starts making all kind of wild accusations and says stuff in front of the jury, or whatever it may be that causes the jury not to be impaneled, and that jury otherwise would have been. But the state takes it into its own hands, and through misconduct causes that jury not to be sworn.
I mean, there would certainly be repercussions for that attorney, but I am not aware of any case that is held that trial is prohibited because of conduct that occurs before the jury is sworn. And all of the cases talk about how when jeopardy attaches is sort of the test, because we're really concerned about putting a defendant through the gauntlet twice. And in this case, the defendant wasn't tried with the first jury. They just got through the jury selection. And so there really is no legal support for appellant's position.
So you're saying the prosecutor may be guilty of contempt, may be sanctioned, may have repercussions for his law license or whatever, but it doesn't impact or it wouldn't cause any kind of mistrial because there hasn't been a trial. There hasn't been a jury
court. Correct. A trial court might decide we need to start over with the jury selection, but it would not prohibit re-prosecution because jeopardy had not attached. And then with respect to the recusal decision, I would just note that the state, as represented by the Summit County prosecutor at the time, did not limit itself to the peremptory strike issue. There was also this pre-trial conversation in which the trial judge had expressed opinion about the appropriateness of the death penalty. And I'm not asking this court to weigh in on whether or not that required the trial court to recuse itself. That is an issue, as this court noted, for the Supreme Court to decide. It has exclusive, the Chief Justice has exclusive jurisdiction over disqualification issues. And there is no case law to support the proposition that the voluntary recusal of a trial judge can be reviewed. I'm not even sure what analysis we would be conducting at that point. We would essentially be sitting as the Chief Justice and deciding if there hadn't have been a voluntary recusal, how would I have ruled on the disqualification? And I think there's no case law to support it, and I don't think the court wants to go down that road because I think it creates some problems. I would just say that with respect to the prejudice, the questions about what is the prejudice, I think that is kind of the meat of these first four issues, because at the end of the day, there was a fair trial that occurred with a jury selected without any challenges on this appeal that rendered the guilty verdicts that are here before the court today. And whether or not things should have been done differently with that first jury is sort of irrelevant because the defendant received the fair trial that rendered the verdicts that are before the court today. And if the court doesn't have any...
I have a linear question on the quashing of the jury. So the second trial court judge said, kind of the authority or the ability to reach into what happened before when this jury was being selected, but to avoid any appearance, I'm going to quash this jury and we're going to impanel a new jury. It's my understanding that the appellant's saying, outside of those double jeopardy issues, just doing that is making a decision. In other words, we lost the right to the first jury, and is saying, because we had everything was going on as it should have, by virtue of the state's action, they effectively lost the first jury, which we had a right to. Whether or not that's a double jeopardy argument or a whole different type of argument, isn't the trial court making a decision when it quashes the first jury and impanels a new one that, in fact, something happened to the prejudice of the procedure that allowed him to quash that jury?
Well, so a lot of the same answers, I think, are responsive to that, because I don't think there was a right to the jury, and I don't think there is any prejudice because a fair jury eventually was convened. But also, I think the trial court's decision and its opinion, I think, is a good one. He walks through kind of the quandary that he was put in. There's no precedent really to guide his decision, and he's in a position of having to decide in the face of allegations of bias in the selection of the jury whether or not that selection was proper. And he asks, does he even have the authority to review his colleague's decision. There's no real answers to that in terms of law or even in case law. And so recognizing that this is a death penalty case, it's going to be looked at for decades, the trial judge says, let's get it right. Let's make sure we err on the side of caution here, and decides to convene a new jury. That doesn't sound unreasonable to me. I think we would have maybe a lot of questions if he had did the opposite. That this court might be even more skeptical with that course of action when there were all these allegations about how the jury was selected in that process. So I think that the trial court acted reasonably within the scope of the law at the time, but ultimately, even if the trial court's action wasn't proper, a third jury was selected and rendered the verdicts that are here today. So I don't think there is any harm or any prejudice under that assignment of error.
Can I ask you a question? Hypothetically, say that the trial would have gone through with that first jury would be here on this trial. State would appeal that. I mean, depending on.
I don't know. I don't know if the state could could have appealed it. If there was, potentially, defendant could have tried to claim some kind of inappropriateness in terms of the selection if the state had secured convictions with the first jury.
Yeah, depending on the outcome.
I think that would be
any way you look at it.
Right. And I think that's especially true in some of these death penalty cases, where, at least in my experience, courts are much more they review things more thoroughly because these are more serious cases and we want to make sure we get them right. And I think that kind of is what the sentiment of that second judge's decision was. Let's get it right. This is a death penalty case. And at the end of the day, a third jury that had nothing to do with these earlier issues heard all the evidence and rendered these verdicts. The court doesn't have any additional questions. I just ask it to affirm.
Thank you, counsel.
Thank you.
The state's characterization that the second trial court's decision to err on the side of caution is reasonable holds no. It does not hold water. The trial court's decision to err on the side of caution says this: state's peremptory trumps defendant's valued substantial constitutional rights. A constitutional system cannot elevate a non-constitutional right above a valued substantial constitutional right. This is a case of first impression. And we submit the most likely reason why it is because no other prosecutor would operate this brazenly. The voluntary recusal is one of only four challenges in this area. So the state's misconduct in and of itself is one, the trial court's refusal to impanel the jury is one.
Would the trial court's refusal to impanel the jury be a final appealable order? I realize we went off the rails here and I threw a lot of time, but
well, in this case it is because of the sequence. Had the defendant attempted to appeal at that stage, it would be 2505-02 when you'd have to go through those multi-pronged analysis. Judge Carr's hypothetical is this case. This is the state going, uh-oh, we don't like the result with this jury. We don't want to try this case to this jury. Now we're going to do and say anything and everything that we have to do to make sure we get a new trial. This is the equivalent of goading a mistrial. The misconduct purposefully prevented the attachment, and the trial court's allowance of that purposeful misconduct prevented the attachment. Chris Regrets holds that the federal rule that jeopardy attaches when the jury is impaneled and sworn controls Montana, through a statute, attempted to push jeopardy from attaching to the swearing in of the first witness. In that case, those defendants, there was no trial. Yet, the Supreme Court of the United States, because of the value, substantial constitutional right to double jeopardy, which prevents prosecutors from seeking a new trial to improve known or suspected weaknesses, and in equal measure, and this is the key, protects a defendant's right to a particular tribunal. Chris v. Bretz elevates that right to a particular tribunal to the level that warrants the remedy that we're requesting. Quickly, I'd like to get into the Miranda issue, which would get to the third trial, and there are other assignments of error in the briefing that gets to the third trial. All parties agree that House controls this challenge. There are three distinguishing features in this case that require the opposite conclusion than that reached in House. First, Mr. Haywood was subjected to a forced, warrantless search and seizure. He had to give a DNA swab. Under Ohio law, the only way the police could require him to give a DNA swab is if he was being contemporaneously arrested on a felony. So he was in custody. He was under arrest by the state's, by the police's own actions. Second, Mr. Haywood was never explicitly told that he could end the interview at any time and return to the jail. But in House, that defendant was told that explicitly twice. And in the U.S. Supreme Court's holding, they reference explicitly that fact, that the defendant was told twice that he could end the interview and go back to his cell. And third, Mr. Haywood, in this case, had been involuntarily uprooted from his home turf, the jail. And he was brought to the police station, and he was put in an interrogation room, which is the traditional coercive environment that Miranda is concerned with. In House, it was in a conference room at his home prison. So these three distinguishing features demonstrate that this was a custodial interrogation.
Counsel, I just have to say something. We're all judges here, and you know there's the case law that says judges know evidence and they'll only consider what's properly before the court and so forth. So we'll only consider what's properly before us and all these things. But I just have to tell you, technically speaking, and I'm only doing this for educational purposes, technically speaking, when you do rebuttal, you can't go back and start talking about stuff that you never mentioned in your first argument. That's not really fair to the other side.
That makes sense, and that was inadvertent.
I know. I'm just doing it for educational purposes.
Okay, I appreciate that.
I'm trying not to disrespect you in any shape, manner, or
form. No, I recognize it, and I thank you, and I apologize to the state. That wasn't my intent. With that, on the first issue, we ask this court to vacate Mr. Haywood's convictions with prejudice, as all of the discussion here in the briefing has been presented to the court.
Thank you both for your presentations today. The court will take the matter under advisement. We will issue a written decision that will be mailed to all sides as well as posted on our website, or the Supreme Court website. Thank you.